Good evening, everybody. It's really, this is one of my favorite things to get to do is talk about this church. I've been a part of this process for a little bit. And, is that okay? Okay. And, you know, we're starting to see this. I mean, we've seen this picture now for a couple of years, but we're actually seeing the bricks and the mortar, you know, just really happening right before our very eyes. So this isn't such an unfamiliar image to us anymore. As Mike mentioned, this was the labor of a lot of people. And our design committee, I guess it was 5 or 6 years ago, somebody, Pat Leach, I think, was the one who said, Norbert, how would you consider chairing a design committee for this? It might be, you know, a meeting once a month, you know, it's not going to take a lot of your time. And I said, you know, yeah, okay, I think I could probably find an hour a month, you know, to work on this. The stories that I've heard about churches being designed, usually it's the pastor and the primary donor and the architect who squirrel away in a room for a little while, and they come out and show you your church and say, now give us, you know, $1 million, and here's your church. And that wasn't the vision for us, and I was happy about that. I was willing to go along with that. This was really, really loud. I'm going to keep moving it down. So, when they said, yeah, but we want you to find a design committee, and so we made up this design committee, and this was the team. This is made up of staff and friars and community members. Let's see if I can make this work. So Adam Stein, many of you remember Adam Stein, was on staff here as our director of youth ministry, and then worked in our social media and communications. Rita Smith, who was a volunteer at the time, she was, Rita, are you here? No. Rita was working with the Art and Environment Committee at the time. And she was moving plants. I remember having a conversation with her, and I said, so what do you do? And she says, well, I'm an architect. I said, really? Mm-hmm. What's your specialty? She says, well, I have a degree in liturgical architecture. And I said, what are you doing in Phoenix? And she said, I used to work for the Diocese of Boston. Until, da-da-da-da. And so she stopped working in Boston, and she was working here, coming to church here, looking around at this, you know, sweet little church that we have now, thinking, wow, we could do better. But here she was volunteering at the Art and Environment Committee, and now she's on staff as the project manager for this. We are so lucky to have her. Brian Kinsey, who was on staff here for 12 years, assistant director, he's still involved with this committee. His wife is on staff here, working in our family catechesis. He's now at St. Teresa's Parish, but definitely a part of this community. Suzanne Smith, who has been here at the Costa since God was a child. she really goes back to the 80s. Suzanne, are you here? I'm sorry. Suzanne was a director of liturgy when I was first hired 26 years ago. And so she's been around in the community for a long time. She's on the board of directors now and really has a degree in liturgy, really a valuable asset to this team. Chris Bork and Pam Bork, usually you don't see them apart, but there they are apart. Pillars in this church. They're involved in so many different ministries. I'm sure you've seen Pam dancing and Chris singing or something, or one of those combinations, maybe Chris dancing. Pam's back here. Hi, Pam. Father Peter and Father Joe, two of our friars that were on this process. Sister Ginger Downey was a friend of the friars, a friend of this community for many years. She had been working at the diocese for many years in the office of worship there, so she really provided us with a great deal of information about how to function, how to do this, you know, in the diocesan world. Father Mark Joseph Costello is our liturgical consultant. Thank you, Jaime. Was our liturgical consultant. He's a Capuchin Franciscan, and he's a member of Father Bill Cieslak's province. So he was also our consultant when we were designing the Blessed Sacrament Chapel, the St. Clair Blessed Sacrament Chapel, back in the early 2000s. Wonderful, just a delightful person to get to work with. And then that little schlub is back. And this was a very serious bunch. I mean, we were really out of work all the way through. We had a lot of fun. And it was an interesting process, because I have to say that we didn't always agree. And that was a wonderful part of the process. We disagreed well, and we debated, and we discussed, and we came to conclusions together. And it wasn't always easy, but it was always charitable. And I'm very, very proud of this process. The one person who's not in the picture, who was a very important part of this team, was Mabel Hoey. Some of you might remember Mabel. She moved away a few years ago to be closer to her daughter. She lives in California now. And her husband, Jim, they had been involved with the community for decades and decades. And Mabel was the voice that would just not mince any words and tell it to you like it was. If she, we saw something and we didn't like, we'd all kind of go, and she'd go, blah! So it really cut to the chase. She was really important to have on the team. But it wasn't just the 12 of us. We had an advisory group. There were about 150 people who were involved at various stages along the way. I think there were 3 meetings of the advisory group. We would present our ideas, and then they would look at it and go, blah! Or actually, they sat at tables and had wonderful conversations, and we sat there and took notes of everything we heard, and then we would go back and process all that information. And it really helped shape what this building is really looking like in the end. We came out, we would go into the meetings thinking, this is the most perfect design ever, and then they would say, oh, well, that's not right, and that's not right, and that's not right. And the group was absolutely right. And we really feel like we got a better design with all of that input. So the floor plan, the basic floor plan of the church is this. It's hard to look at a floor plan and get, you know, too much of, to understand it too well. So it helps to look at it in comparison to our current church seating. So the current church is in the red lines, and the new church is in the black and white lines. A few things that are worth pointing out. It's a very similar shape. The altar is there, and the seating is in the round. Except these people who were sitting on the grass and looking in a glass window and not seeing anything are now inside. And these people who were sitting in the lobby looking at a TV are actually further away than the back row will be in the new church. Wow. That's an important wow. Because you look at the big building, you think this thing's going to be massive. It's not. It's actually going to be the smallest church in the Diocese of Phoenix. The new churches that are being built for 1,500 plus. This will have seating for 600 with some extra space in the back to put up another couple hundred chairs for, you know, big events, like when Christmas gets rained out, for example. if you see this word alcove right there, that's where the music alcove is now when you're sitting in our church. So that's where myself and Adam, the drummer, and MG, and the bass, we're all sort of shoved up in that little space right there. Where the grand piano is where the piano would be for the new, in the new church, and these seats back here would be where the choir would sit. Right now, the choir is shoved under these benches when we do this, so they'll have actually a nice little space. And these rows, instead of just ending, they just extend out. People who are seated outside in the patio over here are actually sitting inside the room now and not having to be divided by a glass wall. So it should feel very familiar. If you're always sitting right here looking over at me, I'm still going to be right over there. Yeah. So we're going to take apart, we're going to look through this floor plan. And I think one of the first things to talk about is this narthex, this red area right up here, this huge entry area. We don't have a narthex now. A narthex is a transition space between the parking lot and you know, the sanctuary, a place where you can make that transition from the busyness and the craziness and the noise of the world into a place of worship with the community. And this narthex, we're already starting to see it, that glass room right there, that's the whole narthex. It's a beautiful, bright space filled with light and plenty of room for us to gather and make the transition into the worship space. The footprint of the bell tower is right there, and you know, we've been watching this bell tower going up. It's really taking shape. I don't know if you're watching the stone going on, and that cross is really being defined now. The bells, I hear, are going to be installed sometime in the next month, so that'll be exciting to see those going up. So if you haven't rung the bells lately, get your chance in, because once they go up, it's not going to be us ringing the bell anymore. So the bell tower is that footprint right there. And at the base of that bell tower, in that red box, is the Reconciliation Chapel. What's a Reconciliation Chapel? Well, in the old days, we called it the confessional. And this was that dark, scary booth with that sliding door, you know, that you would kind of talk into. I love that scene in Moonstruck. Has anybody seen the movie Moonstruck? When she goes in for confession. Forgive me, Father, it's been, you know, whatever, 5 months since my last confession. And she starts going through the list, you know. He goes, let's go back to that second one again. Behind the screen. So this will not be a dark, scary booth. This will actually be a very bright room. These walls here are all white milk glass. There's a piece of art glass that's right in there, a beautiful piece designed by Scott Parsons. I'll show you the design later. But why is this there? The Renewal Center is a place of reconciliation. Our very name, Franciscan Renewal Center, every acre of this property has seen moments of reconciliation and renewal. And this chapel sacramentalizes that action. It's such an important part of our identity as a place where reconciliation happens, a place where renewal takes place. And it's at the cornerstone. It's right there underneath the bell tower, calling everybody into worship. And on that wall, outside right there, I can hold my little red light still, that's where the cornerstone will be. And if you haven't had a chance to go into St. John's Bible Room, you might want to take a little stroll by there and see what's going to go inside the cornerstone. There's some coins and some little artifacts that are going to be part of that cornerstone. There's also some relics in there that will be going under the altar when the altar is put in place. But the cornerstone, that's the prayer that Charlie read at the beginning. It has a beautiful inscription on it which calls us to be the dwelling place, calls us to be the house of God, right there on the building that we're saying is the house of God. I think it's a wonderful opportunity for us to reflect. Oops, something's happened. There we go. So people say, well, this isn't a typical church. I don't understand the design. It's not cruciform like most churches are. There is a central design element to this that's worth talking about, and we call it the central axis. And it runs right diagonally through the middle of the building, starting with the Reconciliation Chapel, and moving on down to the baptismal font, and progressing a little bit further down to the sanctuary space, where we are nourished at the table of the Lord, and we hear the stories from the ambo, the other table that we're fed from. And then a little bit further down that axis is the tabernacle, a place where we keep the reserved Eucharist. That's reserved for really three purposes: for the sick, for those who are dying, and for our own adoration, to recognize God's presence with us always. And then the last part is this piece of art glass that we're calling the beacon, the beacon tower, the light tower. All connected to that tabernacle, that this whole progression, this is our Christian life. This is where we are reconciled to God, to another, and be celebrated in the transformational waters of baptism, and then we're nourished and fed at the table. And then we become Christ in the world, just as the tabernacle is. We're there to feed those who are hungry in the way we live our lives. This is the Casa story. You might have heard us talk about this. We are a place of transformation and healing, a place of spiritual growth, and a place of service to others. This is the Casa story, right in the middle of our church. We're going to walk in these doors. We're going to see the Reconciliation Chapel. We're going to touch the waters. We're going to be fed at this table. And we'll have this tabernacle to remind us what we need to be in the world. Ladies, you're going to want to know. First door on the right. Men, you got two more steps. You got to go to the second door on the right. We're going to want to make sure we get those right. There is a family restroom there as well. There's a hospitality room, which we don't have right now. This would be a place where the brides might wait before a wedding, or the baptismal families would maybe take the children to calm them down or to change them into their baptismal garments. Or maybe a funeral family might just collect their thoughts there before the funeral mass. But it's a hospitality room intended specifically to be available for those kinds of moments. The working sacristy, if you're a lecturer or a Eucharistic minister, that's where you're going to be checking in. It's a nice big room, about three times the size of the sacristy that we have now. And that's only for checking in. It's not for preparing the bread and wine. So if you're preparing bread and wine, that actually happens elsewhere. Big mechanical room for the air conditioning, because we need a lot of air conditioning for this. The priests have a vesting sacristy, a nice quiet place to collect their thoughts before going out and celebrating these beautiful mysteries that we hold so dear. And collecting their thoughts before they preach. Right now they have no quiet place to do that, really. It's kind of a hallway, and everybody's talking to them, and that's kind of fun too, that accessibility, but it is a good thing to have some place to gather your thoughts. And then down the end of the hallway is the vessel sacristies. That's where the bread and the wine would be prepared before Mass. But it's a long way down to get back into the space. And there's a door here, and a door here, and a door here. So if you're heading down here, you've got a couple of doors to get through. It's really off the beaten path. It'll be a clean, safe place to do that. And I think it's something that we really, really do need. Before we put pen to paper on this design, we did something that I'd never heard of before. We sat with Father Mark Joseph, and we wrote the story of this building. He called it the ARC program. It's a document that we have to this day. It's guided us through the whole design process. The ARC program tells the story that we intended to tell. Every story, every building tells a story whether you intend it to or not. The Circle K on the corner tells a story. It's a really practical little place. You can zip in, zip out, get your, you know, gallon of milk and head on home. Every building tells a story. We wanted to be intentional about the story. We wanted to provide some opportunities for deepening our Catholic faith, specifically through the lens of the Franciscan tradition, and we set out to do that. And here's the story that we set out to do. To that end, we commissioned five artists to create, help us create these stories. Scott Parsons did the art glass on the windows. Karen Schmidt did the bronze statue that was already here now. It's in the front entryway. Deborah Luke has created two bas-reliefs for us, one of the Incarnation, which has been inside the church now for quite a while, and it's now been taken off the wall because it had to get prepared to be installed inside the new church. And then we just took delivery of the bronze bas-relief. We'll talk about that in a little bit. Father Mark Joseph Costello was our consultant on this project, and he designed the furnishings, so the altar, and the ambo, and the chair, and the baptismal font. All that was designed by Father Mark Joseph. And then Brother Vincent Nguyen, I have to update this, he's now Father Vincent Nguyen. At the time we commissioned him, he was Brother Vincent Nguyen, you might have remembered him. And he painted that beautiful cross that's hanging in the church, which, by the way, in about another month will be going away because it has to find its way into the new church. But that was the first bit of art that was commissioned for the new church. And so we'll take these one at a time. Scott Parsons, such a delightful man. All these artists, I have to tell you, I've never done this before. I've never built a church. I've never commissioned artists to do great things like this before. And I don't know what I had in my mind, but I really thought that they might be really temperamental, like musicians, you know? Difficult to work with, impossible. Some of you are nodding, yeah. But we managed to find the nicest, kindest, gentlest, most humble, talented artists imaginable. And Scott was the glass artist that we interviewed and ultimately chose. He's from Sioux Falls, South Dakota, and as humble as he is, his website is damnfineart.com, which just flies in the face of who he is, because he is really such a quiet, humble guy. But we set out, we told him, there's a few stories that we want your help in telling. These are important Franciscan stories. One is, we are the Our Lady of the Angels, and there's a Franciscan element to who Our Lady of the Angels is, and we need your help in telling her story. Second story we want to tell in the windows is the Canticle of the Creatures. This is the beautiful poem that St. Francis wrote, right? This is the Brother, Sun, Sister, Moon story, right? You're all familiar with this. And we were clear with him on something. We said we didn't want something really obvious and brittle. So don't bring us a picture of a little sun, you know, looking like a boy and smiling. And, you know, a little moon, very feminine, Sister Moon. We didn't want anything that obvious, because the poem really isn't about those things. The poem is really about the praise that each of those creatures gives to the Creator in the way they were created. The poem says, "Praised be you, my Lord, through Sir Brother Sun, who is the day." So each of these elements gives praise, and we wanted to try to depict what that praise might look like. So as you see the images of this glass, you might not recognize it right away. You might have to look at it for a little bit. But he was willing to take that on. And the third story that's really important to us is the Greccio story. Some of you might have come to see the show that we put on in December, Buonatale Greccio. It's the story of St. Francis in this little village of Greccio, when he did kind of the first live nativity scene. And from that moment, we have the tradition of setting up nativities in our homes and in our churches. But the important part of that story is the humility of the Incarnation that was so important to Francis. It's central to understanding him. If you really want to get into Francis's mind, you have to see Christmas the way he saw Christmas, which was not just a little happy party. It was really seeing God coming to us in the most humble, inconvenient circumstance possible. And so that we thought was really important. So those were the three stories we gave Scott, and he came back with this. So this window will be in that front huge opening that you're seeing as you drive in. And it's called Our Lady of the Angels. But it also includes his depiction of Sir Brother Sun. Praised be you, my Lord, through Sir Brother Sun, who is the day and through whom you give us light, and he is beautiful and radiant with great splendor, and he bears a likeness of you, Most High One. A few weeks ago, I took a vacation, and I went to Germany. And I like going to Germany. My mother's from Germany. I feel very comfortable in Germany. I've been there a lot in the last 40 years. And as it happens, the studio where Scott Parsons works with is about 40 kilometers away from my mother's hometown. And some of you may know this, but my first language really is German. I grew up in the house speaking German. My grandmother lived with us and we didn't speak English. She didn't speak English. So I grew up speaking as a very specific dialect of German. I never studied, so my grammar is horrible. And when I go to this village, it's like talking to family. It's so cool. I understand them, they understand me. Nobody teases me about my bad grammar. We all say the same kind of, you know, silly little expressions, and it's totally easy. So I got to go there. While I was in Germany, I spent 2 days and I went to the studio there. And I have a few pictures to show you from there. When we go through these windows, I'll depart from this presentation and show you a few pictures from there. But seeing this in glass, a totally different experience. I cannot wait for you all to see this. This window will be down here in the floor plan. So as we're going to keep going back to this just to sort of get a sense of it. So as you drive in off of Lincoln, this is what you're looking at. And then the other things that we're seeing will start to take a look at. Brother Wind, praised be you, my Lord, for Brother Wind, and every kind of weather through whom you give us life. This one and the next one share kind of an interesting little space. This is Sister Death. Francis wrote this part of the poem right before he was dying. And it goes like this. Praised be you, my Lord, through our sister bodily death, from whom no living person can escape. Blessed are those found doing your most holy will. For them, the second death will do them no harm. I've grown up my whole life, I think, fearing death, dreading, you know, my parents' death and my grandparents' death. It's occupied a lot of my thinking. I find it ironic that I'm working in a church all these years later, and some of my most gratifying work is planning funerals and helping people bury their loved ones. And this entry, or this stanza of the poem really challenges me to see death differently. Francis says when we've done the hard work of reconciling, when we've done all that, then bodily death is nothing. It can be greeted like a beloved family member, and our dying can be an act of praise. Go back to the first line. Praised be you, my Lord, through our sister bodily death, from whom no living person can. So instead of that scary Hollywood image of death with that hood and the sickle and everything coming after you and the scary music, praised be you, my Lord, through our sister bodily death. These two windows will be right down here in these two little alcoves. When you drive in, you're going to see death. And when you walk in, it's going to be looking at you down the hallway. No escaping it, folks. We'll make it out of this place alive. But what a beautiful reminder to calling us to praise and to welcome it and to live our lives in such a way that when we greet Sister Death, we can truly greet her. Brother Wind is over here. You'll encounter Brother Wind if you're outside here, but you'd also encounter Brother Wind as you're walking this way and maybe heading out. So there's little surprises around different corners. You're not going to see everything. There's no one place where you're going to be able to see everything. Whoops. This one is called Those Who Forgive. And in that same Canticle of the Creatures, at a time many years after he composed the first part, there was this nasty conflict in the city of Assisi between the Bishop of Assisi and the Mayor of Assisi. Can you imagine civil authorities and religious authorities not getting along? Yeah, it's not so different. And Francis's response to that time was not to take sides, not to dig in heels. He wrote this: "Praised be you, my Lord, through those who forgive." He departed from that whole brother-sister convention that he had been, you know, writing with. "Praised be you, my Lord, through those who forgive and bear infirmity." And he goes on about what forgiveness and reconciliation are like. And he taught it to the brothers, and he sent them out into the town square. He didn't call our people in the church and come hear the concert because the boys are going to sing. No, he sent them out into the public square, and they sang it. And the miracle that occurred is that both sides started listening to one another and reconciling. And peace was restored, at least for a time. Because we know how the cycle goes, right? And then we keep going back. "Praise be my Lord to those who forgive." So just like the sun is made for shining and gives praise to God by being the sun, we give praise to God when we forgive, and we're built for it. We're made for it. We're built to forgive and reconcile with one another. So this is what he creates. "Praise be my Lord through those who forgive." It's soft, it's gentle, it's got some really subtle colors of red and pink down here, and green. Unfortunately, the lights kind of wash this out, but this is going to be beautiful. And inside the Reconciliation Chapel, it'll be one of the windows on that wall right there. So as you're in there, pouring your heart out, praising God in your reconciling. The Beacon of Light Tower is intended to be at the end of this axis. So if you're standing here at the entrance looking past the altar and the tabernacle, you're going to see this right behind it. This beacon of light intended to be shining out our beacon of light, what we're called to be in the world. And then Greccio. Francis asked for three things when he went to Greccio. He asked for an ox, an ass, and hay. That was it. And he said, "If you can get all that stuff together and meet me out on the mountainside on Christmas Eve, we're going to have mass out there." And it was never done before. It was kind of a crazy thing, you think, when you think about it. I mean, who would do that? On Christmas, it's cold. We could go into the church and have mass, or we could meet Francis with an ox and an ass and hay out there on the mountain. And something captured the imagination of those people. And the story is that the people came carrying torches, and the night was lighted up like the day. So we have two windows, the torches that lighted the night. And at the very top, Sister Moon and the Stars. Let me see if I can zero in on it there. So the night sky will be way up the top, and those torches, you can just see people coming carrying these torches. And so these two windows, this one and this one, will be right behind the altar. We're going to be celebrating Christmas 365 days a year. This curved wall will be where the Greccio window is. And right in that little opening right there is where the torches window is going to be. And so you're only going to encounter it a couple of times. If you're standing in the center, you'll see the torches light up at night. This wall is made of Venetian plaster, so it will pick up all the light that's coming from these windows. And so all of that light will just be, all that color will be washed onto that wall. And then the Greccio window right there behind the altar, reminding us of who God is and how he comes to us in this really humble form. Sister Mother Earth, praise to be my Lord through our Sister Mother Earth and every kind of flower and herb. This window is done, and I'll show it to you in a minute. I love that it has an Ocotillo branch in it. I love these really earthy colors. I love that it looks like our home around us. It was funny because when Scott first brought us an image, what did it have in it?
I know, something that I've never seen.
It was like wisteria, you know, something that never grows here. And what is that? It's a flower, it's Mother Earth. Like, yeah, that doesn't grow around here. Let's try something that grows. And he'd never heard of an Ocotillo, so we took him for a little drive around, and then boom, they showed up in the window. And that window will be on the east wall up here rather high, and it'll be up there, surrounded by white fritted glass, capturing all that morning sunlight. Mother Earth just shining down upon us. And then down below is where that bobber leaf will be. We'll come back to that in a second. And then Sister Water and Brother Fire. This is kind of an odd slide because it's hard to depict. This is the same glass in three different renderings. If you can see that little thing, recognize that? There it is there, there it is there. So this is a circular window overhead on top of the baptismal font. Two really strong symbols, you know, of baptism, fire and water. The baptismal candle and the waters. So it'll be around in the ceiling, in the coffered ceiling above the baptismal font. And it'll be artificially lit, so it'll always be present to us. But they've started to work on some of this. I think I have a few pictures of these, and the colors are just so beautifully vibrant. And so where we are, back to Our Lady of the Angels. And so we wanted to know, you know, we were so curious what it would look like. And they thought it would be translucent enough that you could see the mountain through it, and that's in fact the case. I've seen the window, and I'll show it to you. Let's see if I can do this. Let's see. I'll go quickly through these. So that's the Greshi window done. Oh, whoops. It's going to go faster than I thought. I want control. Right? Norbert wants control. So Suzanne Smith decided, well, if you're going to go on vacation to Germany, I want to go on vacation to Germany. So she and Tom agreed to go the same time we were there, her husband Tom, and they met us in Wiesbaden, which is just outside of Frankfurt, if any of you have been to Germany. And Wiesbaden is maybe 20 minutes away from Taunusstein, where the glass studio is. Taunusstein is really small, maybe 25,000 people that live there. It's not a very big, there's not a lot there, in fact. It's sort of a kind of a bedroom community for the people who live and work in Frankfurt, and then they live up in the mountains, which is where my mother's family is from. So as we pulled, you can see the window that's off the right, that's the parking lot. We pulled in and we could see this through the window from the car, and I about wrecked the car right in the building. Just beautifully vibrant. So we walked in, it was cold, cold, cold. It was 50 degrees, it was the high. And Suzanne and I just stood there and started to fall apart as we're looking at these windows. I mean, we both just fell into tears because it's so vibrantly rich. These colors are spectacular. That middle section there, that blue part, originally when the design came back, you could see the ox and the ass very present and sort of a symbol of hay. And Father Joe said, you know, this didn't happen for animals, this happened for us. And we talked about this moment, this unique moment in time when this chasm just splits and God makes his way through that and comes to be with us. And you can see shadows of people walking through the darkness and coming into this beautiful presence. And the ox and the ass are there looking on, and some very energetic thing is happening, and there's a lot of movement in this window. It's really fun to see this. This is Olaf. He is the primary painter for this. This is not typical stained glass. There's no leading. A lot of stained glass that we would have grown up with in older churches would have been little pieces of glass all cut out, and then a lot of leading in between it, and then that image would have been what you would have seen. It was like kind of a big glass mosaic. This, they're using, they're painting, they're etching, they're doing multiple firings, layers of glass where they're cutting away glass and revealing what's underneath it. They're layering colors together to create new colors. They're doing acid etching. They're doing silver staining, so they're applying metals and then firing it, and then the chemical reaction changes the glass color. And so I got to meet all the people doing all this, which was really exciting. And Olaf is one of them. He's been a painter there for 37 years. And that, by the way, that he's putting down are the windows for the baptismal font. Brother Fire and Sister Water. And that's Scott Parsons there, who happened to arrive the day that we arrived to check up on how things were going. And he was meeting up with some of the people who were working on it. This guy is just a craftsman who's been there for, I don't know, probably 30 years, and said, I happened to overhear this conversation, and he was in broken English saying, I love working on your glass more than anything else because it's so organic, it's so alive, there's movement inside the glass. And it was fun to hear these craftsmen overhearing these conversations. How appreciative they were of his work, and what an excitement it was for them. This company, Derrick's, has been in existence for 150 years. They have done windows all over the world, really, I saw some of the examples of their work in Singapore and Taiwan and all over Europe, all in probably every continent, I wouldn't doubt. And they did a lot of restoration work after the war. So when the Cologne Cathedral was rebuilt, they did all the replacement windows for that. And so they have 70 people working in this glass studio. And their story is just as interesting as the glass itself. So Mother Earth, unfortunately, can we turn this light off just for a second? Can we just? They're telling us that there's only a few of these, Jeff, and then we can light back on. They're telling us that they are innovating daily with these windows. Carl Pines, who is the project manager on this, presented these designs at a symposium of glass manufacturers about a year ago. There were 50 glass manufacturers from around the world for this symposium, and he was the feature presenter, and he presented these windows. And they were all kind of scoffing at him and laughing, saying, how are you going to do this? You can't do this in glass. And he said, yeah, we're going to do this in glass. I asked him how they would have done it. And he said most of them probably would have just done some sort of a screen print and applied it to the glass. They're doing this with glass layering. I don't know if you can see this, but this is like all etched and painted and silver stained. And it's really quite remarkable. These are really up close that we're never going to see again because it's going to be, 20 feet in the air. But
so if you felt that there's texture.
Oh, there's texture. Yeah, there's texture. That's the tip of one of the Ocotillo flowers. Okay, we can turn the lights back on. I think the most vibrant stuff. We'll turn them off again later. But this is the guy that does this painstaking silver staining and etching. Or silver staining. He's not doing the etching, he's doing the silver staining. So he's applying layers of metal onto the glass, and they fire it, and it changes the color of the glass. This is Roman. Roman is 22 years old, and he's brilliant. He is was a refugee from Kazakhstan. When he was 12 years old, his family escaped some bad situation, and they had some family in this village. And he came when he was 12, and he was thrown into German school. And of course, he didn't speak any German. He spoke Kazakh and Russian. And he failed. He failed at school. And he was a dropout. And when he turned 16, they said, you better do something, because you're not going to go to college. And so he went into a trade school, and he experimented with glass. And he took to it just really naturally. So he did 3 years of study there. And then he was given a three-year apprenticeship with this company. Mm-hmm. And after 3 years, they awarded him this task of working on this window. So the fun part about it is that he's been working on small pieces of glass like this in this little acid studio with really awful chemicals, like, he's all dressed up to protect himself for this. Olaf's been working in his glass studio painting. All these other people have been doing the glass cutting in their little studios and the grinding, and they've never seen it assembled. And when they knew we were coming, they got all the pieces together. It's like a big puzzle, and they cleared off one window, and they created these makeshift sort of, brackets to hold it on, and taped it up to the glass. And then they walked us all in at the same time, and this was the moment that we walked in and saw it for the first time, and it took our breath away. And we just sat there and looked at all the wonder of this. And we will have the opportunity to touch this, because this glass will be approachable. It goes down to the ground and goes 40 feet up in the air. Can you turn off the lights for the next few? Derix, E-R-I-X.
Norbert, will they come to install this?
No. One of them will come to oversee it, but it's all being handled by a local glass installer. Arizona Glass will be installing all the glass. But this kid was telling me, I will never do anything this spectacular in my life again. I can't imagine doing anything better. This is the best work I've ever done or ever will get to do. So that's Carl Heinz, the project manager. He is also the guy who cut all the glass, personally. He wanted to be a part of this. So rather than just project manage, he made himself a glass cutter. Roman is the etcher. Olaf is the painter. That's Scott Parsons, the artist, and Suzanne, and that's Suzanne's husband. And this is only one third of the window. So it goes, you know, there's another two thirds above this. And Roman said, I will never see this window in its entirety because we don't have a place to do this. And I said, well, you're going to have to come to Phoenix. And, yeah. And he just looked at me and he said,
yeah.
I just got married. It's not happening. We could only speak German together because he doesn't speak English yet. He's learning German. And he knows enough to be able to speak in the studio and work. But his wife is from Ukraine and they speak Russian in the house and German. Anyway, we had a lot of fun with this. Olaf working on, this is the, if you recognize that shape, that's that Marian shape in the middle of the glass. He was in the midst of painting on this when we were there. She's one of the glass cutters. She's the favorite glass grinder. They have probably 10 glass grinders, but she is the one who's been entrusted with grinding all this glass. This is Eric. He's one of the glass cutters. He might be the one who comes here in August to oversee it. And then they have the largest kiln in the world to fire some of this glass, because this glass, the centerpiece of the Marian window, will be the largest single pane of this art glass in North America.
Wow.
It's 12 feet tall by 5 feet wide. It will be on a special jet to fly it over here because it doesn't fit into standard cargo aircraft. But this this was an enormous piece of equipment, that kiln. And there it is. So you can see the trees. I don't know if you can see that house right behind it. So it's quite translucent. All right, there's a movie I want to show you. Let's see if I can find it. So I'm walking up on this glass. I hope it's the right direction. And you'll see behind me, or behind the glass, the trees.
Looking at the trees behind the
skeleton. Oh, okay.
This part is rather thin. It will be applied to a carrier glass. So it's not. That was my whole movie. My whole movie. But I thought it was so interesting to see that. You know, we've been looking at flat images for so long that you forget that this is. It's going to react with light. So here's the thing to remember. You will only be on the receiving end of the light to encounter this. So when you're inside the church and it's daytime, you'll see the light coming through the window. If it's daytime and you're outside, you're going to see a black window because the light will be on it. So at nighttime, when the lights are on in the church and you drive up, you'll see it from the outside. But from the inside, you won't necessarily see as vibrantly. It'll be a very different experience. Which is just a great lesson for us to consider and ponder about the source of the light and the light's job and our job as glass to be vehicles for letting a source shine through us and not to be on the wrong side of the light. Let's see if I can go back. Okay, here we are. So there it is. That's in stages. It wasn't done yet when they showed us this. Anyway, it was a very exciting thing to get to see this class, of course. One of the funnest things I think I've ever done in my life, it really gets chopped up rather high, is that somebody said, you know, Norbert's got a presentation about the church. Would you all like to see that? And I'm thinking, no, they don't want to see this. They're busy. They're like, yeah, we'd like to see it. So the project manager said, can we invite a few of the staff? I said, well, sure, you know, put as many chairs in the room as you want. Well, they all came. Like 50 people who were working that day, all crowded in this room, just like you're sitting here and looking at the pictures, and I took them through this whole thing, half German, half English. It was hysterical. For those of you that speak German, you would have really had a good laugh. But they had never had this experience before, where they got to see where their work was going. And they didn't know very much about St. Francis. Like, they didn't know about the canon of the creature. So I was teaching them, and telling them, much the same as what I told you about, you know, what does the sun look like when it's giving praise to God? What does the creature look like when it's doing its best work? for the creator. Well, I looked, and they were sobbing. They were just like weeping, hearing the story, and I'm telling them all about you, and how we've designed this church together, and how we raised the money, and it's done, and we're ready, and we want it. They said, three people came up and said, you know, we would come to your church if we could. For us, going to church is like going to the bank.
Yeah.
You go and you make your transaction, and you leave. But they were so enthralled and energized by hearing about our community and the stories that we're trying to intentionally tell in this. It was really, really fun to get to tell them our story. Anyway, let's move on, shall we? The statuary, Karen Schmidt is a sculptor. She's from Concord, California. KarenSchmidtSculpture.com if you want to go see some of her other work. She has some other work here in Phoenix. One of her beautiful piece that we saw is at, Cam, do you remember where it is in Tempe?
It's at the one with them.
The two women, it's with Mary and Elizabeth. And
yeah, it's like
a hospital, isn't it? It might be at a hospital. I thought it was at a home for unwed mothers, but it's Mary and Elizabeth. And they're standing side by side, holding each other up, both very pregnant. And it was just this woman helping woman. It was such a tender, beautiful expression. There's another one of the Holy Family where Joseph is holding up the baby Jesus, and Jesus has his arms outstretched like this. But it sort of prefigures the cross a bit, and it's really a compelling image. We just fell in love with her work. And so she came and brought us a couple of ideas. We said we want the story. We want a story of where Francis and Claire met towards the end of Francis's life. We already have this beautiful statue of Francis, you know, in full vigor. It's out here in the courtyard. You know, he's standing there with one hand up and one hand down. He's in full energy. And we wanted to depict Francis being ministered to. And so we invented a moment where Francis would have revealed the stigmata to St. Clair. It's not reported to have happened. That's not a legend that's reported to have happened any place. We do know that Francis went to Clair towards the end of his life and was ministered to by her. Remember, she was cloistered, so he would have had to have been allowed in, she would have had to have been allowed out, and so they encountered each other that way. And you've seen the statue where he's showing her what service will look like. A life of service is going to lead you to this. And there she is, on her knees with a towel in the basin, ready to serve him, and she's looking in awe, about to serve, and him showing her this is what service will lead you to. It's going to lead to this. And when we first revealed this statue, some people had come to us and said, why is, you know, she in a servant position now on her knees in front of him? And Father Joe quickly pointed out, she's in the Jesus position. Remember the story, Jesus washes the feet of the disciples, brings a towel and a basin, and starts to serve them. And that's the role that she's in. It also helps us tell the story of Francis' favorite gospel story, which is the foot washing, which he had read to him the night before he died. So it's a beautiful, really important story. And so she brought us a couple of little clay maquettes like this, and I won't go into all both of them, but this one looked like Francis was in a dentist chair. So we kind of But it was so fun when she brought us these, and she would just, well, the hands are not in the right position. She'd kind of move with him. Pam, wasn't she great to work with? Just easy and really wanted to help us tell the story of the life of what a life of service means. So this was poured at a foundry in Burbank, and it happened to be poured the day before the Los Angeles Religious Education Congress that I usually go to in February, March. And so I went a day early, and I saw them pouring it. And that's it at the foundry. And I met all the people that were doing all this, taking it out of the kiln. It was like, I don't know, 3,000 degrees, ridiculously hot. And then chiseling it out. And it's in pieces. You know, I thought this stuff gets poured together in one piece. It doesn't. It's poured in pieces, and they weld it together, and then they magically make it look like it was never in pieces. But it's rather strange to see it in pieces. I sent this picture to her that morning. That morning, her grandson was born, and she was in the hospital and sent me a picture back of her grandson was just born. And I said, well, you've got two things with your name on it today. But it was really strange to see Francis's head and Claire laying there on the side. But then there it is, magically done. And when the church is completed, it'll be in this back corner, I guess, that was prepared for it, with these opportunities for candlelight around it, where we can light devotional candles. And it's intended to be encountered all the way around, so you should be able to walk behind it and see it from different perspectives. I remember talking with the ministers that bring communion to the sick. You know, you're ministering to people who are not well. Francis, in this image, is not well. He's reclining back. He's seen better days. And on the outside of that same wall is the statue, or will be the statue, of Francis in full vigor. So it's like a reminder to us that we bear it all in our bodies. And just when we're old and frail is not the fullness of who we are. It's who we are in that moment. And to remember that we're also fully vigorous people as well. So there it will be. And then right that little circle right there is where this statue will be. So when you drive in, you'll see Francis greeting us in the driveway. You know how that little space right there. The bas-reliefs, this is Deborah Luke, the sculptor. She's from Baton Rouge, Louisiana. She's the most adorable accent ever. I can't even say how she says my name, Norbert, with a Louisiana accent. But again, another delightful person to work with. We wanted two stories from her. We wanted the incarnation of Jesus, the nativity, his birth, and we wanted his resurrection. If you go into many Franciscan churches, if you travel in Europe or really around the world, you'll see a lot of art depicting both the birth of Jesus and the death of Jesus, or the resurrection of Jesus, in some balance. You might see the cross on the one end of the church, and if you turn around and look, there'll probably be a Holy Family or a Nativity of some kind, else like on the other end of that aisle. Or if you walk in a door, there's a big painting of the crucifixion of Jesus. If you look to the right, you're probably going to be one of his birth as well. So this was our attempt to do that, to hold the specialness, the uniqueness of Jesus in a very special way. So she created this resurrection of Jesus that's now on the outside of the church. This was poured at a foundry in Denver, and I went in August to see it because I have to see these things, and it was poured in 22 different pieces and then stitched together, and then she was there in the cold to oversee the patina of it, how they finish it. And now we've got it here. On that same wall, but on the inside then, will be the nativity that we've been looking at so beautifully that she created. So this wall is surrounded by glass. It's separate from the rest. And I think this is really a special wall. On the inside of that same wall then is where the nativity will be. Highlight the uniqueness of who Christ was. The architect, who I don't have a picture of, but I really need to get a picture of him in here, Dan Clevenger, who's been working with us so patiently all 5 years of this design process and is still engaged with us now. He commented that when he saw this bas-relief on the wall, he said it looks like Jesus is emerging out of the wall and lifting the wall up with him. Like, to see this whole thing being lifted up, like he's taking it all up with him. It's a beautiful story of the ascension. So that's where that wall is in this drawing. Father Mark Joseph Costello did the furnishings, the altar, the ambo. You know the story of Greccio, where Francis asked for the ox and the ass and the hay. A very important motif, then, is the hay. And so the hay will be everywhere. You'll see it carved into the wood of the altar. The hay, the food for animals, becomes the bed for Jesus. It becomes the place where our food then is, the bread of life, on top of this hay-carved altar. And the hay carved in the ambo, and hay carved in the side of the presider's chair. So all the furnishings down front will have this hay motif in them. The wall right behind it, beneath the Greccio window, is pressed in with straw. And so the hay will be right there, very texturally, like touch-worthy. The hay will be around us. There's only two steps going up. We needed to do that because in the current church, we have a very steep slope. Some of you probably encountered that when it's a little slippery. Or if you're not certain on your feet, it can be a little steep. In the new church, the slope is not as steep. It rises 1 foot over 20 feet. And so to accommodate then the difference in height, we raised that 1 foot. So it's two steps going up. I was in a church in Denver this summer, and it was five steps going up to the altar. It was another four steps going up to the ambo behind it, and another three steps going up to the tabernacle. Such a hierarchical experience of church, you know? So different from our imminent presence, you know? The accessibility of it is so easy. So it's not really, really high. My little grand piano over there. But this hay motif will also be in the baptismal font. It's carved into the side of the stone. It's a full immersion font and a slump glass bowl that will be there for us to, you know, dip our hands into. This will be the primary source of holy water when you enter church. This will be the place where everybody will stop. And that baptismal font is right there. So when you walk in the door, you might see something like this. The reconciliation chapel is behind you, looking down at the floating pews, which are going to have feet eventually. But we couldn't afford legs. Baptismal font and the sister water, brother fire window with a skylight with natural light coming in over the water, the light upon the water. It's pretty cool. And then the nativity bas relief, you keep them going. There's a window there. There's the big Marian window over there. Frank Basilisi designed the donor wall concept. It was important that we recognize everybody who was a part of the story. It would have been a very different story had this been paid for by two or three people, or even 10 people. But to have thousands of names on this story board tells a story. And so this will be etched glass. Part of the design, if you can see these dots all the way around it, was the insignia for the Renewing Lives campaign. And this, some of the lore around this goes back to a conversation we had years ago about how to describe how the Renewal Center functions. We have all these different departments. And so somebody said, you know, if you look up at wind chimes that are hanging, and you see all those little tubes there, and they're just there static, and when a nice little breeze comes along, they activate, and they start to create a sound and harmonize together. And that's that story right there. All these individual little tubes doing nothing by themselves, and together they create something really beautiful and harmonious. So it's etched glass. It'll be hanging in that wall, and so you'll be able to see through it. You'll be able to see the stone of the church through it with our names there, right on. Brother Vincent Nguyen, of course, he's almost as tall as the cross, painted this. I hope some of you got a chance to see. Did anybody get to see him working when he was working on this?
Yeah.
He had the little studio, he had his room over here. It's now the construction office. And he was remarkable. He painted without any kind of, you know, what do you call it? Like, yeah, he never had any kind of apron on or anything. He just would sit there and he painted. He did, yeah, no smock or anything. It'll be hanging there on that wall. There'll be a little frame around it, so it's going to be a little larger than we see it now in the church. To give it a little bit more heft. But he was just remarkable. He painted it all freehand. You know, it wasn't like a stencil or something. And he painted a couple. He painted one for San Luis Rey, in the mission in Oceanside, and he painted one for us. And at the bottom of the cross, in the original cross, it's a little faded. It's hard, you can't really clearly see it. Well, he took the opportunity to personalize it for the places that he's created. So in the one in Mission San Luis Rey, that's the old mission and that's their new church, and Father Nguyen, who is the founder, is at the bottom of their cross. At the bottom of our cross, this is a horrible picture, but you can see Camelback Mountain and Nami Mountain and Our Lady seated in the center, surrounded by the angels.
Aww.
Our Lady of the Angels. And there's a couple of cactus there, too, if you get a chance to go through that. But it's our cross, and we'll be hanging on that wall right there. So we're getting an organ. And the big conversation happened when a donor showed up and said, I have to preface this story by saying this was one of the best bits of luck in this whole process. We hadn't planned on putting an organ in the church, and we were well along the way of designing this church, and a donor came forward and said, well, you're going to put an organ in the church, of course. And we said, well, no, actually, we haven't planned on putting an organ in the church. And, well, I think you should have an organ in the church. Maybe you should talk about that. And so we thought, well, let's talk about it. Should we put an organ in this church? And the acoustician said, you can't put an organ in this church. This is acoustically wrong. And we said, what do you mean it's acoustically wrong? And so as we started to have the conversation about the acoustics, we found out the acoustics were wrong for us, whether there was an organ or not. It was a wrong acoustic. And so we are really grateful, eternally grateful for this conversation, because it turned a very big potential problem around early on, and that's when we could have fixed it. So we looked at pipe organs, and we were really so far down the path of creating this design that pipes would have really been too problematic. So we thought, well, okay, we can get a small little organ. A friend of mine was the music director down at St. Barnabas in the desert, Dr. Kurt Sather. He had been there for, I don't know, 15 years, a fine organist, and he became our consultant on the project to find an organ. He left here, and he became an apprentice for Manuel Rosales, who is probably one of the premier organ builders in the United States right now. He built a Disney organ. I think he's built one or two organs here in Phoenix someplace. But he came to us and he said, you don't want to put a pipe organ in this place. It's not going to work. I think you should try this new technology. And it's called digital. That may sound like, oh, we've heard that word before. Well, in the organ world, that's fairly new. Electronic organs would take an octave of an organ sound and then digitally recreate all the other sounds. And that's how they invented all those other sounds you hear on most electronic organs, and that's why it kind of sounds a little funky. This new technology uses a huge base of memory and goes into specific churches and records every pipe in the acoustic of the space and every stop in the acoustic of the space and records that organ. And so when you get this organ, you can select which organ sounds you want. And so we've actually selected three. And this is what the console looks like. It looks like any other electronic organ. And it'll sit right over there in the music area. But we have selected the sounds from three organs. One of them is from the Lawrence Kerk Church in Rotterdam, Holland. This is a Baroque church, a Baroque organ. It's really a masterpiece, but that's what it looks like in Rotterdam. The sounds will be spectacular. It'll sound like a Baroque organ. This will be the first church in the state of Arizona with this technology. It's pretty new. This technology was actually invented for organists who wanted to practice at home and have something nice to practice on. And they couldn't afford, you know, the really big expensive organs in their houses, but they wanted to practice on what it would sound like to play on a real pipe organ. So it was actually created for that purpose, but it sounds so spectacular that when you put it in a space, you close your eyes, you think you're standing in the cathedral in Holland. So I went to go hear one of these in a church in just north of Milwaukee, in a little tiny little wood frame church with a ton of carpet. Stand in the middle of that, close your eyes, you swear you're standing in a cathedral someplace else.
How do you let them play the organ?
Well, that's yet to be determined. I'm not an organist, but I'll probably have to. Jaime's going to play the organ, right? The second sound set is from a romantic organ in the Abbey of Saint-Étienne in Cannes, France. Probably not a sound that we will use very often, but if we were to have an organ concert, for example, and we were to do some French music, they might call upon the sound set from this organ to play that. Yeah, it'd be really fun to get to hear. And the third one is a contemporary organ from Melbourne, Australia, from the Scots Church in Melbourne. This has been rebuilt 12 times, the most recent time in 1999, and it's a very nice sound. This will probably be the sound, if we use it much, it'll be this one in liturgy. I don't expect our worship style to change, you know, all that much, but there are times when an organ would be really awesome, you know? I can think of funerals and weddings and maybe big celebratory events. We are all aware of the problems of organ. They can really be overpowering and too loud, and that's a problem of the player, not the instrument. You know, so we have to find ways of incorporating this beautiful. It just becomes another palette to paint with. You know, if you're a painter and you have colors on your palette, oh, look, a new color showed up. Let's paint with this one for a while and see what we can do. So we have that to look forward to. The tabernacle will be right there, and a little view of what it might look like. We'll also have there on display one of the volumes of the St. John's Bible always. So this becomes, you know, the tabernacle of the Eucharist and the Word. I mean, this little chapel of the Eucharist and the Word. Connected with this beacon light tower really is our mission in the world. But this tabernacle design is really simple. The word tabernacle means tent. You know, it comes from the time when they didn't believe that God was present, and so they constructed this tent right in the middle of their camp, and they said, this is where God is. This is where we're going to say God is always. So we never forget that God is always with us, among us. And so Father Mark Joseph created a tent-like structure for us, a very simple tent. It'll be in a bronze It's hard to see the lines, but it looks like they're being opened, like the tent is just being opened for us. It's accessible to us. This is just a cardboard sort of mock-up of what it would look like. And then it'll live over there. So as you're standing there, you'll see it, and the beacon of light right behind it. There's a few other special features that are worth talking about in the church that are quite exciting. Let me just hit them briefly. The hearing loop, the LEED silver certification, the bells, and the exterior stone. So hearing loop, is Sharon here by any chance? Sharon, I want her to get the credit. Sharon Barone came to me one day and she said, what are you going to have in here for those of us who have difficulty hearing? And we had actually planned on putting in a little wireless receiver and then people could get headsets and put them on their head and they could hear it. That's, if you go to Gamage sometimes or auditoriums, that's not uncommon. The thing is that you have to put this thing on your head. You have to stand there, sit there around everybody else who don't have things on their head. And you have this thing on your head that points to you saying, oh, look at you, you got a thing on your head. And what is well documented is that people with hearing loss really don't want to broadcast that to the world. And that's not something that everybody's comfortable with. And aging populations really need to rely on this more and more. We couldn't have possibly had 600 of these headsets available to us. But there was some new technology that she brought to our attention. It's called a hearing loop. It's been around forever, but it's not been used in this kind of a situation until recently. Now they're using it in auditoriums and in classroom settings and in some churches. This, though, was a huge undertaking for us because we're not having carpet or tile on the floor. This had to be buried in the concrete. So I'm very proud of the fact that we're going to have this in the floor. What it means is it's a copper wire that's buried in the concrete. And if your hearing aid has a T-coil switch on it, all you have to do is switch it. And whatever's coming through the sound system goes right to your hearing aid. Which gets right past all the acoustic problems of rooms that are, you know, loud or noisy and lack of clarity. So the thing is, though, it's incumbent upon you, though, to have the hearing aid that has that switch. Not all of them do. You have to ask for it. But it would be a very simple switch just to turn that on, and you'd be in complete control of it. However, you have to sit in these three areas in order to avail yourself of it. We couldn't put it in the proximity of music because the wireless instruments over there were going to create a problem. And so it's in these three areas. And we're going to keep praying and lighting candles and doing novenas that this actually works, because we have had to be innovative in this process. It has been really a labor of love to make this thing happen, and I'm so proud that we're actually getting it. LEED certification. LEED stands for Leadership in Energy and Environmental Design. A green building certification program. It guides the building construction, operations, and maintenance towards environmental sustainability. It's based on prerequisites and credits. There are four levels, and in our case, we're attempting to achieve a silver certification. So somebody can help me out. I think it's platinum, gold, silver, and then green. I think you're just certified after that. And it's a third-party independent verification system. It's part of a nonprofit U.S. Green Building Council. These kind of buildings save energy, they lower operating costs, they optimize health because they have to get rid of all kind of toxic chemicals, and they have to keep out any kind of harmful chemicals. I'm very proud to say that the Church of Our Lady of Angels will be the first LEED Silver House of Worship in the state of Arizona, and the 15th LEED Silver House of Worship in the United States.
Wow.
That's huge. There are hundreds of thousands of churches in this country, and for us to be the 15th to have this is really remarkable. But as a Franciscan place that says environmental sustainability is important, we had to do this. We had to do this. We had to put our money where our mouth is, and it was a lot of debate in the beginning because this was a decision we had to make early on because it affected how we designed, how we're constructing. It's all being credited. How we're doing this construction is all being observed. We're getting points for things and not getting points for other things. Silver was the highest we could get because we're not on a tram line or a bus line. There were things that were built into the system that prevented us from getting higher than silver, but I'm very proud of the fact that we're getting a silver. The bells are kind of fun. We named them, we blessed them, dedicated them. It was the year before last, right? January 1st, we rang in the new year, we dedicated them to three Franciscan saints, Blessed John Duns Scotus, St. Agnes of Prague, and St. Catherine Drexel. So those are kind of fun. If you haven't had a chance to ring them, please go out there and do that. They'll be up soon enough, and then we're going to be hearing them. And we'll likely hear them daily around the property. So I think it's not been decided yet, but I think it would be expected to hear them in the morning, noon, and night, and then maybe at weddings and funerals and calling people into mass. And, you know, whenever Jaime hits the button, because he's going to have the remote control. The power is in the remote control. You all know this, husbands and wives. Who's got the remote has the power. The stone. There's a story with the stone. It was inspired by the original Por Siempre, which is the original Our Lady of the Angels. There's this rough stone at the bottom, and then there's this beautiful ethereal heavenly upper part. And that difference is what inspired our stone choices here. That this lower, rough, earthy stone is really grounded deeply in the earth. And then this beautiful, lighter, more ethereal is what we aspire to. I love how the cross and the bell tower blend them together. And inside the church, the pillars that go through the center are the white heavenly one coming right down into our midst. I think it's really a cool story to get to tell with this building. That's all the pictures I have to show you.